Good morning and welcome to today's online worship service. We're so glad that you've joined us wherever you are, whether in Anvil and the surrounding areas or out of state or even out in the world somewhere in a different country. We're so glad that you've joined us. And today's a special day for us because today is the first day of our missions week. And you'll see that on the screen behind me here. It's a day we turn our attention out to the world because we know before Jesus Christ ascended back to the Father, He commanded us to make disciples, not just here locally, but make disciples of all nations. We have that command, that great commission from Jesus Christ, and He empowers us and helps us to do that. And so today we're going to turn our attention not only here to Anvil, but reaching outward to the ends of the earth. And so if you would, before we go any further in our service, let us bow our heads in a word of prayer to our Heavenly Father. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for another day that you've given us. God, we know every day is a gift. God, you don't promise us a certain number of days, Father. So therefore I pray that as your children, as your followers, God, that we would be faithful every single day. God, we would keep our hands on the plow. God, we would keep our eyes fixed and focused on you, God, that we would be faithful in carrying out the Great Commission. God, we know that you called us to make disciples of all nations. I pray that we would be faithful here at Anvil, but also reaching out to the ends of the earth. God, thank you for your help in this. You don't just leave us to do it on our own, God. Your word says just before you gave that command, God, all authority in heaven and on earth, all authority and all power has been given to your Son, Jesus Christ. And so we go in His authority, God, making disciples, proclaiming the good news that your Son, Jesus Christ, has died and been raised back to life. Good news that your Son, Jesus Christ, is Lord of lords and King of kings, Father. And so I pray that as a church and as followers of Jesus Christ, we be faithful in that. God, knowing that you've called us to that, and God, we look forward to even that glimpse in the book of Revelation, to see people from every nation, tribe, tongue, and language worshiping you there in heaven, Father. We look forward to that day, but until then, I pray that we'd be faithful in carrying out the tasks that you've given us. In the next few moments, we would spend this time together worshiping and praising you, missionary God, and whom nothing is impossible, made a way for us to be in your family and initiated and brought us into your kingdom, God. So thank you. We praise you for that. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Just to open us in prayer, but if you have some prayer requests, I encourage you to mention those and comment, send those out. I want to mention a couple. We want to continue to remember our local nursing home and those that are affected by the coronavirus there, the staff and also the residents. Remember those that have lost loved ones recently connected to the virus. Also, we want to mention by name Aretha Harden, our dear sister Aretha, who is going in for surgery tomorrow morning. We want to pray for her. Praise the Lord that the surgery got scheduled. So therefore, we want to lift her up to our Heavenly Father. So remember her tomorrow morning especially. Also, we'll take this time, too, to see who all is on. So if you're on this morning, you want to just send out a message and let us know that you're on. And if you want, just take a picture of your family. That would be nice so that we can see one another. Sometimes we see messages, but if you want to take a picture of your family and maybe send that, put that in the comments so we can at least see some of you and see who's watching, how you're watching, that would be wonderful. We also want to remind you of the 7:19 prayer. We're going to be praying for other things this week and in Missions Week, but let's continue to pray at 7:19 p.m. every single day. Also want to mention a revival that's happening this week. I got a call earlier this week from Brother Jim Morgan from Green Hill Baptist, and they're putting on an online revival, and they've titled it From COVID-19 to the Cross. And there is a page, or I guess it's a group, on Facebook. You can find that. Do a search for From COVID-19 to the Cross Revival. Go on there and add yourself to that group. And every night at 6:30 p.m. online, they're going to be having a sermon. And you can see the lineup down here on the list. I'll be preaching on Thursday, And if you see, it's just an all-star lineup. It truly is. I'm humbled to just be able to preach and to be considered amongst this group. And so if you have any questions about that, or if you have trouble finding that, just give me a call or message me this week, and I'll help you with that. That's going to be starting tonight with Brother Jim Morgan at 6:30. I want to mention our giving. As always, you've got a couple ways to give. Thank you for those that have been giving. You can give, send a check to P.O. Box 64 in Anvil, or if you go to our website, whether you can use it on your phone or on your iPad or your laptop, computer, or whatever that you have, you can go to anvilbaptist.com, click on the Giving tab, and you're able to give that way. I want to mention a couple things that are happening this week connected to Missions Week. And the first thing is this, is every day at around noon, I'm going to send out a prayer. And we're going to pray for a certain individual or maybe a certain group, maybe a certain area in the world. And I'm going to post this list on Facebook, so you'll see that list. But then every day at noon, I'm going to try to send out an all call and mention what we're going to be praying for. We're going to be praying together at that time. So let me just stop and say, if you aren't on our all call list and you would like to be on that list, then please let me know and get me your telephone number so I can get you on that list and you can and receive not just this week for prayer, but also we send out regular updates, prayer requests, and sometimes encouraging notes as well. So let me know if you're not on there. Another thing that we're going to be doing this Wednesday at 7 p.m., we're going to be going Facebook Live, and I'll probably do it just from right here. We're going to be having a presentation on our shoeboxes. And every year, once we send the shoeboxes out, they let us know where our shoeboxes have gone. And so this Wednesday, I'm going to be leading us through a time of just a presentation that's going to reveal where our shoeboxes went. And I'm going to be talking a little bit about that country, where they went, maybe showing some videos and some stories. And that helps us to see kind of what our efforts went into and the impact that we had, because that was something that we did last fall, but we want to let you know that. So that's this Wednesday at 7 p.m. It's going to be on our Facebook page, Facebook Live. One of the things that we focused on, and we really had a three-year plan for this, and God's sovereignty and the way that He works, we don't know, it may be longer than that. We hope it will extend longer than that for sure. But we wanted to focus our missions efforts on here, near, and far. And last summer, we really focused on here, and then this summer, we wanted to focus on near, someplace that was a little bit closer to us, but still farther away. And then the third year, kind of on a far, maybe even an international focus. So we're still working in that ways, in that direction, so to speak. But this year, I wanted to invite a church planter from Dayton, Ohio, and he's a guy by the name of Fred Clement. He's a pastor up there, and he's connected with the North American Mission Board, and he was actually scheduled to be here with us today, and he was going to preach for us, and we're going to bring out the red carpet treatment for him and his beautiful family and have a good old potluck, Baptist potluck meal and celebrate. But of course, that didn't work out given the circumstances. We still plan to have Brother Fred and his family here with us and preach for sometime in the future once a lot of this dies down. But in lieu of that, and instead of that, I asked him this week to just send us a video, just an update to let us know what's going on with the church plant there in Dayton, Ohio. And so right now, we're going to play this video, and once we get done playing the video, we are going to pray for him and his family. So let's roll this video and let's see what Fred has to say to us.
Hello and good morning, Pastor David Tetch and Anvil Baptist Church. I really wish I could be there with you today, but as you all know, that is not our current reality. I wish I could be there bringing in the word, sharing some recent happenings, and just enjoying some good fellowship. But we're living in interesting times. We're doing our best to practice social distancing in a display of loving our neighbor. So we're doing our part, but I really wish I could be there with you guys. But I want to provide some updates, a few updates to encourage you all. So We were serving at Meadowdale Baptist Church, but as of March 31st, the pastor resigned, and I assumed the position of pastor of Meadowdale Baptist Church. Now, this is not a surprise to anyone. This was a part of the transition process. It's been exciting, but also challenging, because I can't see anybody in person. We haven't met or gathered in person as a church. We've been doing everything online. So it feels a little disconnected at times, but I've been doing my very best to contact everyone, to pray for everyone, and to stay engaged with everyone. We're actually planting one family church at that location, and we're looking to plant that church in, sorry, my baby's right there. We're looking to plant one family church in early 2021. So we're planning on having outreach events. We're doing things to engage the community. We're also looking at Meadowdale Baptist Church as a legacy replant. We want to nurture the members, the body of Christ at Meadowdale, grow that church, and start one family church with the existing members of Meadowdale Baptist Church. They're super excited about that as well. We also have a very great local partnership church, and they are agreeing to become our sending church, our sponsoring church, and to help us with our immediate needs, and also the launching of One Family Church in 2021. They're also helping me film all my sermons for each week, and we broadcast those on our YouTube channel on Sundays. That is Meadowdale Baptist Church, if you wanna check those out. And also I'm meeting with my core team each week, and we're developing strategies to engage the community. We're looking at a nice vacation Bible school this year. I've spoke to David about that, and we're exploring some ways of incorporating you guys in that, maybe bring some volunteers or missionaries up to help us with that. We're super excited about that. So those are the updates for now. We're excited. I also wanted to say thank you again to Pastor David and Anvil for being our first partnership. You have been a great encouragement to my life and my family's life. Church planting can be challenging and stressful at times. And I remember on several occasions, I was having a hard day and Pastor David would send me an encouraging email or an encouraging text message. It was extremely helpful for those times. So with that, those are the updates. I hope it encouraged you guys. I'm looking forward to seeing you and rescheduling our time together. So with that, have a blessed service and a blessed rest of your day. Thanks. See you later.
Let's pause just for a moment and let's pray for Brother Fred and his wife, Ekai, and their boys, and the church plan, One Family Church. And just as he said, they're planning on launching in January of next year, 2021. And so let's just stop right now and let's pray for them. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your faithful servant, Fred. God, thank you that you caused our paths to cross, not only One Family Church and his family, but also my family and Anvil Baptist, the Anvil Baptist family as well, Father. And so I thank you for his faithfulness and the call that he has accepted, the work that he's put into to preparing himself, but also the church for this transition, God. We know that we need more gospel-focused and gospel-proclaiming churches around the world, even in the States, God, even in places like Dayton, God, knowing that folks are still living in darkness and are separated from you, God. And so I thank you for Fred and his family, that you've placed him where you have, and that they've answered the call, God. And so I pray that you provide for them. Take care of all their needs, God. Be with them, and during this time, God, I know it's a difficult and kind of a strange time to be planting a church in the midst of the coronavirus, God, but we believe that your sovereign hand is at work. And so I pray that you continue to equip him and even this church that they're going to be planting, Father, and even the legacy church, God, of Meadowdale. God, pray that you use those individuals who've been faithful and who've been serving that community for years, God. And I pray that you would use them to plant this church that would be a beacon of light and would let your light shine Father, they would make disciples there in Dayton, and they would be sending out missionaries into the rest of the world, Father. So use them mightily for your kingdom and your glory. In your son's name we pray. Amen. We also, one of the ways that we can get involved in their ministry right now is to be writing notes of encouragement to them. And so here's their name. You can see it here. You can write that down. I encourage not just families, but kids to be writing notes to encourage them and the church. You can also write it out to One Family Church. That's the name of the church plant. But we're going to be placing just a box outside of the church sanctuary. And you folks can write those notes and drop them off in the box. That's not just for kids and families. This is for every individual. This is a way for us to encourage these folks, especially in this difficult time. They were actually planning on planting the church this fall, but they've moved that back some until January. So I encourage you to just spend some time, stop this week, and write a note. And you can even either drop it in the P.O. Box 64 or drop it in the back in the box that we will set out front. And so I encourage you to do that. And there's a chance, as he said, we may get to go and get boots on the ground, so to speak, there in Dayton. But well, we got to kind of wait and see how the situation is, and so we'll keep you updated on that. Another way that we can help them, and you go to the next slide here, is giving towards this ministry. And they've got a lot of expenses as they get ready to launch this church. And so if you want to give towards this church plant and to Pastor Fred, what you can do is send a check, same P.O. Box 64, but make sure you designate that towards Fred or One Family Church. And then if you give online, after you give online, there's a way that you can designate where you want that money to go to. So I encourage you just to be generous in our giving to help them out, because I believe in what they are doing and know Fred and know his heart for the Lord. And so at this time, we're going to transition to a time of worship and turn it over to Brother Greg.
There shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of the Lord. There shall be a season of refreshing. Take from the Savior above. Showers of blessing. Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops from us all falling. But for the showers we need. There shall be showers.
Turn our attention to God's word. I want to begin just by asking a simple question of why do we do Missions Week? Why do we have a week every year where we set aside time to focus on missions? Well, I want to just share a story with you. The pastor and theologian John Stott, he once visited a small church in an English village. And after hearing the content of the pastoral prayer, which never strayed beyond the interests of that small community, here's what he said. He said, "I came away saddened, sensing that this church worshiped a little village god of their own devising. There was no recognition of the needs of the world and no attempt to embrace the world in prayer." Notice what he said there. He said, I felt like this church, after hearing their prayer, he said, "I felt like they worshiped just this little village god of their own devising with no recognition of the needs of the world that was around them." Now, my hope and prayer as a pastor is that would never be us, just worshiping just a little anvil village god of our own devising. And also, I never want us to be a church that's so inwardly focused that we forget about what God has called us to away from ourselves. And so that's a part of the reasons I always want us to do Missions Week, is because it helps us to be reminded that God has called us to a task that's bigger than ourselves and that goes beyond just Anvil and just Jackson County. And it reminds us of the Great Commission that God has called us to, that he's called us to make disciples of all nations. But it also reminds us that we serve and worship a missionary God, and that God sent his son to this earth, and he was the greatest missionary, because he came to another place, and he came not only proclaiming the kingdom of God, but initiating it and setting into motion the kingdom of God here on this earth. And so we want to participate with God, and we want to be faithful in what he's called us to here in Anvil, but also stretching out, reaching out to the ends of the world. Because I think one of the temptations for us, especially in this time of COVID-19, is to become so inward focused and focused about how our lives have been affected and changed and how we can't meet. I look around in an empty sanctuary and we think, man, we can't gather together for worship, and we can't do this and we can't do that. And it's kind of this, we get this woe is me kind of attitude, and I don't want to minimize the struggle that we go through and some of the impact that this has had on us. But I think the temptation is to become so inwardly focused that we then forget to look outward and reaching out to the ends of the earth and to those even around us, those that are even in our neighborhood, those that are in our community. And so I think this, I debated on whether to even do Missions Week this year because of all that's going on. But I thought, you know what? I feel like we need it more now, more than ever. to keep the main thing, and that's worshiping God and helping others to know and worship Him, taking the gospel to the ends of the earth. And so today, as we open God's Word, we're actually going to be turning to the shortest book in the entire Bible, and that is John's third epistle. It's a book that we don't spend a lot of time in. If we do, we just kind of zoom right through it. But we're going to kind of camp out in 3 John today. And the verse is going to pop up on the screen. But if you start in your Bible looking for that, it's towards the end of the Bible. And this isn't John, the Apostle of John, or the Gospel of John chapter 3, where you find the great John 3:16 and Jesus' discussion with Nicodemus. It's towards the end of the Bible. It's the third letter of John. And when we read through this book, we're going to see, and we're not going to read all of it, we're going to read most of it, but we're going to see two things. We're going to see two examples, two individuals who were involved in missions, or you could say not involved in missions, because one is a positive example from God's Word, and the other one is a negative example from John, from 3 John. And so let's jump into this. I'm not going to read all of it up front. I usually do that, or sometimes I do. But we're just going to take it bit by bit and walk through it. And as we do that, I want us to focus on two examples of missions in this passage. And the first one is this. The first example is a guy by the name of Gaius. Now, who is Gaius? Let me just, a little background, at least what we've got here. Verse 1 says that Gaius was the recipient of this letter. So that's what 3 John is. It's just a short letter. It was a short letter written by a guy by the name of John the Elder. Now, I believe this to be John the Apostle. So John the Apostle is writing a letter to a guy by the name of Gaius. Now, the New Testament mentions 3 other instances of the name Gaius. You've got Gaius of Corinth, you've got Gaius of Macedonia, and you have Gaius of Derbe. Now, is this the same as one of those? We don't know. But Gaius was such a popular name in that day that it's likely that it's neither one of those. So what we really just have to take on or to understand is just what we get from this letter about Gaius. And John tells us a few things. But it's clear from this letter that John knew Gaius. They had some sort of relationship. We don't know exactly how deep that relationship was, but this letter was an introductory letter. And so John writes to Gaius, and he calls him beloved in several different places. But then in verse 1, he also says that he loves him in the truth. He loves him in the truth. And then in verse 2, like many letters in those days, there's a prayer or a type of blessing. And John writes, and here's what he says about Gaius. He says, hey, I pray that your physical health would prosper just as your soul prospers. Now, that's a compliment in a sense. Now, we don't know if he's having any sort of physical health issues, but we do see that John acknowledges that Gaius' soul was prospering, was prosperous. And how do we know that? How did John know that? I think it's going to lead us into what else he says about Gaius in this particular passage. Because in this passage, John is going to praise Gaius for a couple of different things. He's going to give him praise and say, you're doing well in these things. So that's what I want to focus on. The first thing that John praises Gaius about is the fact that he believed and walked in truth. He believed and walked in truth. Let's show this from the text here. Let's go to verse 3. John says, for I rejoiced greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth. Verse 4, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. So John, he says this, he said, I'm rejoicing over you guys. Remember, he's writing a letter to guys. He says, I rejoice over two things. First off, he says, hey, guys believed the truth. That's this phrase here, truth that is in thee, back in verse 3. But not only did he rejoice over the truth that was in him, that the truth that he believed, but he rejoiced that he was walking in truth. And in verse 4, he actually says, I have no greater joy. John says, hey, it's a glorious thing. I rejoice when I find that my children walk in truth. Now, was he his literal son? Probably not. It's possible that maybe guys had come to faith through John's ministry. We don't know that, but maybe John was just older, and so he viewed him as a child in the faith. But either way, he says, I experience deep joy when I find that my children are walking in truth. And see, here's why I mentioned both of those. And I think it's important that John mentions both of those, that Gaius wasn't just walking in truth, but he believed truth and he was walking in truth. Because when we talk about the Bible, when we talk about faith in Jesus and being obedient to Jesus, it's one thing to believe truth. It's another thing to walk in it as well. And see, they must go hand in hand. What God calls us to is to believe truth and to walk in truth. Because here's the thing. If you truly believe in something, if you truly believe something is true, then you will act upon it. And on the flip side, if you say that you believe something and you don't live it out, then you've got to question whether you truly believe what it is you say that you believe. Now, let me give you an example of this. Do you believe in hell? And I know that's away from the passage, but just as an example, do you believe that there's a place called hell that God's prepared for those who are disobedient to him and who do not put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, and that people will spend an eternity in hell in this place of torment? Do you believe that? And I know we live in a day and time that a lot of people don't like to talk about that. A lot of people don't believe in that. It's not very PC. It's not the right thing to say. But God's word clearly speaks about it. And we see that God has prepared that for those who have not surrendered their life to the lordship of Jesus and put their faith and trust in Jesus. So here's the question. If you say that you believe in hell, then the next question is do you act as if you believe it? Because if you truly believe that there's a hell, then what are you going to do? You're going to make sure that that person, your family that doesn't know Jesus Christ, you're going to be praying for them regularly. You're going to be telling them about Jesus. You're going to be hoping and praying that they surrender their life to Jesus so they don't experience hell. When we go out and we meet people, maybe in the workplace or in our school, and they don't know Jesus, we truly believe that hell is a place, a real place. It's going to cause us to act differently. And I think so often we don't act differently because we don't truly believe it. And the same way with missions. Here we are in Missions Week. Do you believe in missions? Do you believe that the church and us as individuals that we are called and commanded to spread the gospel to the ends of the earth? Because then if you say, yes, I do, then the next question is, well, what are you doing about it? It's easy to say that we believe something, but if we truly believe something, it should lead to action. But that brings us back to Gaius, because Gaius not only believed the truth, it says that he was walking in it. And how do we know that Gaius was walking in the truth? What was the truth? I believe it's the truth of the gospel, the truth of God's word. How do we know that he was walking in that truth and not just believing it? Well, because of what's said next, and the next way that John praises him. Because the first thing we see, John praises Gaius for believing and walking in the truth. But the second thing he praises him for is that he helped missionaries. Let's go to verse 5. It says, beloved. There's another instance of him saying beloved. Thou doest faithfully whatsoever thou doest to the brethren and to strangers. Now in this verse, it's hard to tell exactly what he's talking about, but he's talking about brethren and strangers. And he says, what you do to them, he says, what you faithfully do, whatever you do to them, you do faithfully. So who are these individuals? Well, in those days, you would have itinerant preachers, teachers, evangelists, who would travel from place to place, preaching and teaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. We saw this a lot with the Apostle Paul. When he went out with Barnabas and later on with Silas, they would travel around and they would proclaim the gospel, trying to plant churches and trying to be faithful to spread the gospel to the ends of the earth. And so they, in a sense, and I call them missionaries here because in a sense they were, because they were traveling from different places trying to plant churches and also trying to teach and proclaim the gospel of Jesus. But as they traveled around, here's the thing, they had to stay somewhere. And in those days, in the Greek world, oftentimes the inns were connected with the brothels. And we can see a young or an itinerant minister, whether young or old, that would not be the most savory, wouldn't be a very savory place to stay. It wouldn't be the ideal place for holiness for an itinerant evangelist to stay. And so, like the Jews would used to do, is Jews, when they would go to another place or another city, they would look for a fellow Jew, and they would stay with them. And so the Christians, they picked this up as well. So when they would travel to another place, they would find a Christian that was there, maybe a church, and try to stay with them. And then, in order to kind of help make this process easier, a well-known person would write a letter and hand to that itinerant minister, and they would carry that letter. And you can see how this comes in play with this letter. John, no doubt, wrote this letter to some of these itinerant ministers and handed off to guys and said, "Hey, guys, I can vouch for these guys, help them, take care of them." He says here, it'd be faithful to do whatever, to take care of these guys. And so here in this passage, I think this is what's happened. And John is praising Gaius that it was a good and faithful thing that he does to help these brothers, these ministers, these missionaries, these itinerant evangelists that were traveling around. And these men, not only did Gaius help them, but these men go back to John and they give a good report about Gaius. Look at verse 6. Says, "Which have borne witness of thy charity before the church." So Gaius, these itinerant ministers, had come to him, and what did he do? He showed charity. He showed love. He showed hospitality. And these men, oftentimes, they were strangers. Gaius didn't know who they were. He just maybe had this letter from John or from someone else. But what does he do is he helps them. He shows them true love. And in John then he encourages him in the next verse to continue to do this. And he tells him why he encourages him to do this in the next couple of verses. He says, "Send them on," verse 6b, "whom if thou bring forward on their journey after a godly sort, thou shalt do well." He says, you're going to do well. Continue to do what you're doing. Help these men as they come and do and treat them in such a way that he says the word godly sort, but treat them in a godly manner. Treat them with love. We serve and worship a God of love. Treat these men with love and respect. And John has no doubt that Gaius was going to continue to do that. In verse 7, he gives another reason why he should do this. Because that for his name's sake, they went forth. So they went forth in the name of Jesus Christ to do his work. They were his servants. They were Christ's servants. But also because they took nothing of the Gentiles. The itinerant ministers, they didn't take anything from the Gentiles for their work. Now, was this out of principle? We don't know. But also we've got to stop and ask, why would a Gentile, why would a pagan support the ministry of a Christian? I mean, that's just usually not what happens. And the same is for missionaries. If God's people do not support and help missionaries and church planters, then who's going to help them? Now, a quick time out. I understand there's times in God's sovereignty and the way he works. He does use unbelievers to promote and advance the kingdom and the gospel and to help his children. It does happen. But that doesn't seem to be the norm. The way that God has intended for God's work to go out is through the help and the work of the church of Jesus Christ. And an amazing thing he says too here at the end, listen to verse 8. He says, "We therefore ought to receive such," so receive these men that are traveling, "that we might be fellow helpers to the truth." So John says, hey, when you receive these men, these ministers, these missionaries, when you receive them and help them, you become partners with them for the sake of the truth and for the sake of the gospel. And that's what's amazing, is when we as a church or as individuals, as families, when we help people who are missionaries and church planters, we become partners with them for the sake of the truth and for the sake of the gospel. And I believe in that in the same way we reap the harvest that they reap. We participate in the blessing that they receive from the Lord. We're partners in that. And what a joy and blessing that is. My family, even to this day, we support a family in the Middle East. We by sending money and by encouraging them and hearing updates and praying for them. And we do that, why? Because we believe the work that they are engaged in. We know that they're true and faithful ministers, and we want to participate in the harvest and partner with them and all the work that they are doing. I want us to do the same even as a church. So when we look at guys here, he didn't just say that he believed Jesus. He didn't just say that he believed in the importance of showing love. He didn't just say that he believed in the gospel being spread and shared to others. He didn't just say those things. What did he do? He lived it. He proved it with his actions. He proved it in the way that he helped these missionaries, these itinerant teachers. And John, here's the thing. John acknowledges the work that he did. Acknowledges his service to these men, and he praises him. And you may say, well, what's the big deal? It's just John praising. No, this John is writing under the inspiration of the Spirit of God. And so in a sense, if John's praising him, God is praising Gaius for the work that he had done. Because he didn't just believe this or say that he believed it. He lived it. He walked it. And so let me stop this morning and ask you this. Does this describe you? This morning, are you like Gaius? Or you may say, well, maybe not. Maybe for some of you, you may say that you love God, but you never talk to him, you never pray to him, you never read your Bible. Maybe you say that you love your neighbor, but you never actually show it. Maybe you say this morning that you believe in the gospel, but then you never share it with anybody. You say that you believe in missions, but then you don't support missions in prayer and by giving, by going, or even by encouraging. And so maybe, instead of being like Gaius, maybe a lot of us, maybe we're a lot more like a guy by the name of Diotrephes. And I want to take a look at his example now, because his example follows right after Gaius in this letter. It switches to Diotrephes, and we see a contrast and a stark difference. And I always say that when you're reading God's Word and you see in the passage contrast, I always say take a special notice of that. And we see a very strong difference between Gaius and Diotrephes. Because the first example that we talked about was Gaius. And of course, if you figured out by now, that was a positive example. Now we're going to look at a negative example in Diotrephes. And we learned three things about him just from a couple of verses. Number one, we see that he put himself first. Look at verse 9. It says, I wrote unto the church, but Diotrephes, who loveth to have the preeminence among them, receiveth us not. See, the first thing we learn about Diotrephes is that he loved to have the preeminence amongst the people. And no doubt he was a part of this local church. And it says he loved the preeminence. What does that mean? He loved himself. He wanted to be first. He was all about me, myself, and I, you could say. He put himself first. And as I read this a little bit about him, it made me think of the Pharisees that Jesus calls out in Matthew 23. He says, the Pharisees, he says, they love the places of honor at the feasts and the best seats in the synagogues. In many ways, Diotrephes was acting very pharisaical in this regard. But not only did he like to put himself first, but number two, he slandered others. Verse 10 says this, wherefore if I come, I'll remember his deeds, which he doeth, prating against us with malicious words. See, Diotrephes was using wicked and slanderous words to make accusations against the brethren. And we don't have all the details, but my guess is if he loved the preeminence, he was using slander to make sure that he kept the preeminence, that he kept himself first, and that nobody messed with that. So not only did he put himself first, he slandered others. And number three, we see that he did not help the missionaries. Let's look at the second half of verse 10. And not content therewith, neither doth he himself receive the brethren, and forbiddeth them that would, and casteth them out of the church. Whereas Gaius was quick to help the missionaries, we learn this from the first example, Diotrephes, he did not receive these missionaries, these itinerant ministers. And see, what I love, what's crazy about this as well, is that not only did he not help the missionaries himself personally, that's bad enough, it's an indictment on him, but he also cast out of the church those who were trying to help them. I mean, that's amazing, because he's saying, it's one thing to say, nope, I'm not going to help them, but then to not allow anyone else to help these men of God, these men sent by God doing God's work. See, Diotrephes, we see it's clear just from the way he acted that he was controlled by the flesh rather than being controlled by the Spirit. He was controlled by the flesh and living out its desires and focusing pridefully on himself. That's a true sign that he was living according to the flesh. Because Diotrephes, if he was in the local church, he might have said, yes, I believe in Jesus. Yes, I am a Christian, but he was not living it out. He may have claimed that he believed truth, but he was not walking in truth. And I want to just reflect, I was reflecting this past week on a story back in the 1700s and of a young William Carey. Now, William Carey, if you don't know that name, he became the father of modern missionaries and modern missions, and very well known. He was a missionary to India. But when he was a young man back in the 1700s, he was surrounded by a lot of Diotrephes. And here's why. Because at one point in the 1700s, at a meeting of Baptist leaders, when God had started to stir up in William Carey just a desire and a heart for the world and for the missions and reaching the lost, he stood up in a meeting of Baptist ministers to argue for the value of overseas missions. And here's what happened. He says he was abruptly interrupted by an older minister. And here's what this older minister says to him. He says, young man, sit down. You are an enthusiast. When God pleases to convert the heathen or the unreached, he'll do it without consulting you or me. And I thought, wow, isn't that a perfect example of Diotrephes there? This young Carey, kind of like a Gaius, ready to just help those that are doing the Lord's work. And this man saying, sit down, be quiet, and snuffing out any desire that he had for missions. A great example of Diotrephes from the history here. But thankfully, Carey had a heart like Gaius. And he continued on, and he persevered, and he pressed on, and would eventually end up in India, where he spent many years ministering. And at the first part of his ministry there wasn't very fruitful, at least not outwardly. But in the long run, he had a fruitful ministry, so much so that we're still talking about him today. So now I just want to just do a quick review. We've talked about these two examples of Gaius and Diotrephes, but let's just review. First off, with Gaius, we see that he believed and he walked in the truth of God. How do we know? Because he lived out that truth in love. He welcomed itinerant teachers and missionaries, even those that were strangers, individuals he didn't know. He showed them love and kindness and hospitality, and he treated them in a godly manner and participated in their ministry, and I think he even participated in the harvest and the blessing of their ministry. But on the other side, you have Diotrephes, and he was very different from Gaius, because he loved to be first. He was self-centered and inward focused. He slandered others, and he did not help the missionaries and would not allow others to help them as well. And so as we reflect on these two examples, as individuals, as families, and as a church, we have a choice. Are we going to follow the example of Gaius? Or are we going to follow the example of Diotrephes? Let's go to verse 11, because really the Apostle John kind of lays out this choice for us as well. After talking about Gaius and Diotrephes, he goes on to this verse in verse 11. Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God. But he that doeth evil hath not seen God. See, Diotrephes in this passage gives us an example of an ungodly and evil example to follow. It's clear from this. Now, only God truly knows. But based on what the Apostle John is saying, he's saying that Diotrephes, he didn't know God, or he had not seen him, because why? He didn't act like it. He didn't show it. He might have said, I believe this, but he didn't walk in it. But Gaius, on the other hand, gives us a good and godly example to follow. And that's actually where we get the title of today's message, the good, godly Gaius. Because why does he give us a good and godly example? Because he acted in a way that showed he belonged to God. He acted in a way that showed that he had seen and he knew God, because he acted, here, don't miss this, because he acted in a way that God acts. You may say, David, well, what are you talking about? Here's the thing, we serve and we worship and we exalt a God who is good. A God who shows compassion, a God who shows love, who shows hospitality even to the stranger. Because here's the thing, God, this good God, this loving God, he shows it that he truly is good and loving, because he sent his only begotten Son to this earth as that great missionary to save people who had sinned against him. And not only God, but his Son Jesus. We see Jesus. He acted. He showed love and goodness as well. Why? Because he was obedient to his Father in everything that he did, live that perfect sinless life. And at the end of his life, he gave his life on an old rugged cross for the sins of the world, for you and for me. Because before he went there, what did he say? He said, I didn't come to be served, but to serve and give my life as a ransom for many. That's what he said. And so he loved his neighbor. And if anybody could have said, you know what? I'm going to be self-centered. I'm going to focus on my own preeminence. It was Jesus. But he didn't. He humbled himself, took on the form of a servant, and he willingly laid down his life for sinners. He willingly, sacrificially helped others in a way that we could never have helped ourselves. And let me stop here and say this. If you've never made the decision to follow Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, repented and turned of your sins and turned to make Jesus Lord of your life, I beg you, I encourage you, do that today before it's everlasting too late. And so as we come back to this, we see that Gaius, what was he doing? He was following the example of his Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Because all the things that John praised him for, we see that God's word shows and reveals that's how Jesus Christ is and how he acts. And so the choice is us, and the choice is ours. Are we going to sacrificially follow Gaius and ultimately follow Jesus, or are we going to follow the example of Diotrephes? And so what does this look like for us? If we bring it back to talking about missions, what does this look like? Well, I believe that each of us must genuinely ask, is God calling me to be a missionary? Maybe that's overseas. Maybe that's in the States, North America. I think we all ask that question. But also I realize that not everybody is called to that. I think we ask God, is this what you have? For the majority of us, that's not our calling. I realize that. But we are called to be on mission wherever God has placed us. And in a sense, we're little missionaries to our own community. In our own town, wherever God has placed us, but definitely called to be on mission, faithfully proclaiming the gospel. And then if we're not called to go on mission or to be a missionary in an overseas type of context, I believe God has called us to help those who are called to do it. Because we're all in this together. We're all part of something bigger than just Anvil Baptist Church. We're part of God's family. We're part of God's kingdom. Praise be to God that God's kingdom is like that mustard seed that's planted, and it's growing and expanding. And we have a choice whether we're going to partner and participate and help in that with God and with God's Spirit. And I love the story that before Carrie eventually went to India, William Carrie that I mentioned earlier, he told a friend, and he said this, as he was getting ready to leave, not knowing what was ahead of him, he said to his friend Fuller, he said, I'll go down into the pit if you'll hold the ropes. I'll go down into the pit if you will hold the ropes. Are you willing to hold the ropes for brothers like Fred, Pastor Fred, like Brother Neville, Pastor Neville, that we read his note last week as he ministers there in South Africa, and other places and other people around the world who are down in the pit? Are we willing to hold the ropes for them? Are we willing to pray, to give money, to send our children, maybe even grandchildren? I know that gets a little scary for us. Are we willing to send those we love to carry out the mission? Are we willing to go ourselves? And are we willing to encourage those who are willing, who are already on the field? Are we willing to do this? You see, we say that we believe in missions, but do we live and walk out that truth in our lives as individuals, as families, but also as a church family? Do we live out that truth in our lives? And I pray, as pastor of this church and your fellow brother in Christ, I pray that we will never be a bunch of diatribe faces. That when we look around the sanctuary, when we get back together, that I'd never look around and say, "Yup, diatribe face. No, we want to be a church full of Gaiuses who are ultimately following the example of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That we would never be like diatribe face, selfish, inward focused, and unwilling to help others and unwilling to participate in missions. That we would be like Gaius, and may we believe, like Gaius, may we believe and walk in truth. May we show kindness, love, and hospitality to others, and may we faithfully proclaim the gospel where God has placed us. And may we pray, give, go, and encourage mission endeavors. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the example of Gaius that ultimately points us to a greater example. That's your Son, Jesus Christ, who willingly laid down his life, Father. Well, such a great example of love and goodness and hospitality. God, I pray that we'd never be like Diotrephes, self-centered, walking in the flesh, inward focus, God, but that we would be outward focused, willing to show love, ready and willing, God, at any time, but also maybe even, God, looking for ways to serve, looking for ways to participate in missions, God, knowing that it's not just about us, it's about your kingdom, it's about your glory, Father. So I pray for faithfulness in this, God, that you would help us in this, and that we would be faithful in where you've planted us as well, here in Anvil, Kentucky. And God, we would live on mission, knowing that you're going to be with us every step of the way. God, if you're for us, who can be against us, God? You promised us your presence to the very ends of the age, God. May we faithfully proclaim the gospel. And may we, as the book of Acts says, God, may we see the world turned upside down by our work through the power of the Spirit and through the work of the gospel, God. That's my hope and that's my prayer. In your Son's name we pray. Well, thank you all for joining us for today's message. Be on the lookout this week as we have times of prayer. And don't forget Wednesday night as well when we unveil where the shoeboxes went. Knowing that that is one of the ways that we're able to actually extend our influence and minister to folks abroad as we partner with that particular ministry. And if you're here today or if you're there, wherever you are, and you've made the decision to follow Jesus Christ, if you have more questions about that, please contact us. Let us know how we can help you, how we can be praying for you. And again, we want to just say that we miss you all and we love you very much and looking forward to gathering in person in the days to come. But until then, we're going to keep our hands on the plow and our eyes fixed and focused on Jesus Christ. Have a great rest of the day. Take care and God bless you.